Hi, my name is Tracy Yemma, and I'm a registered dietitian. And tonight we are going to have with us Melissa Canestraro, a registered nurse, on NutriFacts. And we are going to talk about how you can be an advocate in your own health care and how you can be a member of the team. I'd like to welcome you to the show. Melissa has been, this is a second career for Melissa. She decided to go back for nursing because she was so passionate about the field that she decided to get a degree in it maybe 8 years ago, and she's seen thousands of patients in the course of her career. So tonight we're gonna talk about the types of things that you can do as a patient to make sure that your needs are being met, that you're being heard, and that you know how to ask the questions that you need to ask to make sure that you're taking the best care of yourself that you can as a member of the healthcare team. Thank you, Melissa.
Thank you.
Why don't you tell me a little bit about your educational background and training?
Okay. Well, I went to school at Mass Bay Community College, and that's basically where I got my nursing training, that type of thing. And I've been able to practice in a variety of areas, for example, within the Department of Corrections, as well as...
Yeah, I didn't know that when I saw your history. I thought that must have been fascinating.
It was quite interesting, yeah.
Yeah.
I initially did it because I wanted to explore psychiatric nursing, have experience in trauma, as well as having the med-surg that's usually required coming out of school, so, yeah.
Okay, and so tell me, you know, I mentioned briefly to the audience that you had a passion for nursing. It was a second career for you.
Yep.
Tell me how you became interested in that field. What really motivated you to go back to school?
Well, over the years, I mean, I was younger. My mom was very ill and she passed away when I was fairly young. And I was able to see wonderful nurses come into my home to help care for her. And then as I got older and had children and became a patient myself, I was able to receive care from amazing nurses and felt that I really felt that they were truly blessed for doing what they did. You know, they had an opportunity to affect so many different people, and I wanted to be able to explore what it would be like to be able to offer that. So,
And so tell me a little bit about the different types of positions that you've held and the different work that you've done over the years.
So initially I started working in the Department of Corrections, and everyone asked if I worked with the women, and I did not. I worked with men at the Supermax up in Shirley. And it was actually initially a very interesting experience, but I was not certain if I really liked it, but I stuck it out and I stayed for about a year and a half. From there I went over to an acute care facility over in Worcester. Had wonderful experience. I was initially a float pool nurse, then I ended up going into cardiac, and then acute care. Like, I was basically a rapid response nurse and responding to those patients that were circling the drain, I guess, in some ways.
But like heart attacks.
Exactly, having strokes on the floors and basically coding. And I was one of the rapid responders. So that was a fascinating experience. And then prior to leaving St. Vincent's, unfortunately that position was eliminated at the time, so I ended up going into the operating room for a short period of time, and I actually learned a lot there as well. But
I can imagine.
Yeah, it was awesome. And then during the whole time in working in the hospital, I also, as well as in the prison system, I kept my hand in home care, and that was something, one of the initial positions that I had come into as well. And kind of just kept my hand in that area, and I love it. I think it's phenomenal, and I think the experience that I have in the hospital helped the patients that I help serve in their homes, and I felt that my experience in the homes helped to serve those patients in the hospital because I was able to kind of see both sides and be able to educate all the way around.
Right.
Yeah.
So. Just for the audience, so can you just help people understand, like, what is home care nursing? What does that mean?
Well, basically, I mean, usually the nurses go into people's homes when they've had, like, say, a hospitalization for whatever reason, whether it's a chronic disease that's kind of flare up, for example, like CHF or COPD, diabetes, that type of thing, or maybe even surgery. Sometimes people require nursing in the home after having surgery, for example, a knee or a hip. And then we go in, monitor the patient, you know, on behalf of the doctor, because a lot of times it's very difficult for them to get out of the home to see their physicians. And then we basically provide a lot of education, and the goal is to, you know, offer short-term nursing care intermittently until the patient's able to kind of be independent, and teaching the patient and the family to be independent with the medical care.
Yeah. Now, what does your work involve now?
Well, currently I am very fortunate to, I would say I have the best job in the world, but I currently do work for Steward Healthcare, and I am a key care manager. I work in the population health group, and I am given a population of patients that I work with that have complex and chronic disease management issues that cause them to be at more of a risk for hospitalization because mm-hmm. they're not managing those diseases properly. So what I do is I work with them over the phone, actually, and I basically introduce myself that I'm willing to support them in their health and wellness, so hoping to improve their health as far as teaching them ways to manage and improve their outcomes mm-hmm. and not maybe going to the hospital so often, but maybe learning to be a bit more proactive in their health mm-hmm. management of their diseases. And mm-hmm. So a lot of times it's a very positive, I think a lot of patients look at that as very positive, and they kind of take an interest. And unfortunately, I see a lot of patients that for the first time they're having a problem, and maybe they haven't done anything up to that point, but they then, now that they've had a scare or whatever, now they're mm-hmm. willing to kind of take that next step and learn a little bit more in a way to prevent further hospitalization. So.
Now, can you give an example of the types of diagnoses that you would work with?
So typically, the patients that I work with are patients that have congestive heart failure, mm-hmm. COPD, and as well as diabetes. Some have renal failure. Some have skin issues. You know, it depends upon, the level of function. Sometimes they just have issues with being able to care for themselves physically, mm-hmm. and you kind of work to get the supports in to help them maybe exercise or work with a physical therapist or whatever to improve that so that they can become a little bit more independent if mm-hmm. they're able to and if they're willing to. So.
Yeah, I would imagine too, you see patients that have multiple
exactly.
situations,
exactly.
not just one.
Yes, I mean, that's a lot of times it's what the case is that I have more complex patients because they have more than one of those diagnoses. So the combination of those diagnoses has caused them to be a higher level of need.
So what's typically like the flow of care for the patient? So they get discharged from the hospital and mm-hmm. then somebody reaches out to you about yeah. them potentially needing care?
Yes, that's a lot of times when I get like brand new referrals on patients. Typically I get a monthly list from physicians that are saying, okay. These are the patients that I have who require a little bit more care.
Yeah.
And I would appreciate the fact that you could reach out. So a lot of the communication comes from the PCPs, which is nice because you've got those PCPs are kind of aware that these people need additional supports and they know that we're available.
What do you do after that? You call them and you see if they're interested?
Exactly. So I call, I reach out. A lot of times I, call and just chat with them, figure out what's going on. And I have access to much of their medical history, and as well as hospitalization. So I can, converse with them about that and, mm-hmm. and see, find out what led them to go to the hospital and what is it that their concerns are and what do they want to change and improve. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
So when you're working with a patient, how do you help them set goals?
Generally, when I work with a patient as far as setting goals to improve their health, because that is part of the role that I'm in, is that I try and motivate them to make small changes. So usually the goals are pretty small. I mean, a lot of times, and I've said this multiple times, especially when you're trying to teach a patient who has CHF or COPD and they're looking to quit smoking, it's not that they need to look at quitting, they need to just look at cutting back. And so making those goals attainable and mm-hmm. realistic, something that's easily measured. So if they smoke 2 packs a day, what is that, 40 cigarettes. So if they knew yesterday they smoked 40 cigarettes, then today, let's see if we can smoke just 38 or 37 cigarettes. And in a way, it's just so small that they may not notice the change, mm-hmm. hopefully. Mm-hmm. I know sometimes when you say you can't, you want to focus on that, but at the same time, you're kind of just getting them in a different mindset and slowly improving to, reaching those goals. So mm-hmm. hopefully today they're smoking 2 less cigarettes, and by next week or by next month, it's maybe 10 less cigarettes a day. So if you can do it gradually and make it easy to achieve. Then
I think the hardest part to help patients, in my experience, has been the hardest part to help patients really feel good about that is trying to help them understand what it would mean over the long term. Like patients that would come to see me for nutrition would get so frustrated with their lack of weight loss or slow weight loss.
That's right.
And I would say, but if you lose 1 pound a week, that's 52 pounds in a year. I mean, yeah, don't minimize exactly. that.
Yeah, and that's
a huge accomplishment.
And that's exactly what I say to patients all the time. I mean, I had a recent patient that had a blood result that came back, and his A1C, which is the measure of his blood sugar over the
long-term
blood sugar level. So he went from a actually a 10.0 to a 9.9. And I was like, you know what? That's an improvement. You didn't go up to 10.1 or 10.2 or 10.5. You went down. So that's great. You have to recognize that the work you've done to change that and make that improvement, keep that in your mind and continue to move forward and continue trudging along. And it's a long road. It took a while to get where he's at now with his health. So it's going to take a little bit while to turn things around and improve them. So
I think that's the frustration for patients. I know I would say to patients too, and they felt like it was a consolation prize. I would say, you know, if you've had a history of gaining weight over a long period of time, even just to stop that progression of gain
even
is
just
still progress.
Absolutely.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. No weight gain is still success.
Exactly.
But, you know, it's hard for patients to really, I think because they're so focused on the end result and how do you get people to think about the right now and not so much where you want to be in a year.
And that's exactly what I try and do is focus on the right now because that's really what people want, that immediate gratification.
Yeah.
So if you can, you know, even though when I'm working with someone, I will a lot of times just kind of reflect on where they've been and where they are.
Wonderful.
So that you can, you know, kind of just keep that positive reinforcement, which I think is always good, you know.
Yeah, definitely. Now, what do you feel most passionate about with regards to patient care?
Well, I think that one of the most important things is just learning that it's okay to talk to a doctor or have a conversation about your healthcare. A lot of people I find are, I think in the older generations, they are a bit intimidated with having those conversations. They don't want to question the doctor. And the younger generations have kind of learned to ask questions and they explore things a little bit more, whereas, you know, people that are a bit older don't. And I think it's important for patients to realize that you need to have those conversations to help you feel confident. Mm-hmm. And it's not always conversations that you necessarily need to have directly with your doctor or with the specialist, but maybe with another person of the care team, for example, the nurse that works in the doctor's office or the medical assistant, someone that you're feeling comfortable with, and that person can then maybe understand their concerns, maybe relay them to the doctors, as well as maybe having a resource, a pool of resources to pull from to be able to help them get the answers if they're not able to, you know, supply them directly. Mm-hmm. I find that a lot of you know, offices work sometimes with a diabetic nurse specialist because, you know, that's a common disease. You know, it's helpful and some, you know, visiting nurses, like even to say, well, you know, it sounds like if they're having issues with mobility, but they don't want to tell the doctor or whatever, maybe it's not recognized by the doctor. You know, if they communicate that to the nurse, at least have that conversation, then maybe someone can look to help support them with that as well. But if you don't express your concerns or questions, the doctor's never going to know that they are there. And
yeah, I was having so many thoughts as you were talking because I was thinking too, I think sometimes people don't even realize that there is a problem that they need to have a discussion about. Like,
you're right.
You know, you and I were talking earlier and you mentioned the whole changing the medication and if they think they can just pop all the pills in the morning and get it over with, realizing that some are supposed to be timed accordingly.
Yes.
And they may not even realize what a big deal it is. So they're not bringing up the conversation because they're not realizing that it could be an issue.
Yeah. And maybe they, you know, sometimes when people go into the hospital and they have medication changes, you know, and you're not feeling 100% when you're in a hospital usually.
Yeah.
And I always recommend that you have a friend, a trusted friend or a family member that can kind of fully grasp the conversation with you or participate in that conversation so that they can ask questions that maybe the patient may not realize they need to ask.
Yeah.
And like you said, it is important to certainly, sometimes those medications need to be taken separately or at a certain time to realize the best benefit.
Well, you know, and sometimes too, I think that even for people like I'm in the field, even when you see when I see a doctor, I find that sometimes you've got these emotions running. You're like, oh my God, what are they going to tell me? And what if I forget to do this? And I don't know if I can understand everything he's saying. He's talking so fast and I can't catch it all. Some of the things that I've done is I will bring if you have a smartphone, you can actually audio tape the conversation.
That's a good idea, yes.
You probably have to ask for permission, but
no, but I'm sure
I do it because I want to replay it back in case I forget. There may be, especially people have surgery and there's like multiple steps. You have to wash it and clean it and dress it and do all these things.
I mean, hopefully you're getting provided also written information because that's really the most important.
But the written information is like 15 pages long.
Correct. Yes, you're right.
When there's really like five major steps that you need to do, but because each medication has 5 pages of warnings and recommended dosage and timing and risks and it's very overwhelming.
Yes, it is.
So very having the person there or taking notes when you're there, I've always found that to be very helpful.
I agree. And I think that, you know, family members, they just, when you have a family member that's been in the hospital and you know that they may have a little bit of forgetfulness or maybe they're a bit hard of hearing, or just feeling a bit overwhelmed, just offer to be there to help support them so that you're a second set of ears for them and you can reiterate or confirm whatever, you know.
Exactly, so, what do you think are your patients' biggest challenges?
You know, I would say, I think that, I think education, unfortunately, sometimes the patients aren't always, you know, not, knowledgeable enough. I think it's it's important to get that. But I think one of the things, as I started to mention earlier, is that sometimes patients wait until something bad happens before they actually tend to do something about a disease process. You know, they could be diagnosed with CHF 3 years ago, but not really changing what needs to be changed to improve that or stabilize it, but continuing to live going along the same way that they've always been. So things get worse. So by waiting at that point, they're actually ended up putting themselves in a position of being reactive to a problem. And I think it's really appropriate and more important to be proactive so that you're in a clear place and you know, clear mind, hopefully, and you can make the appropriate choices as to avoid, you know, further issues or rehospitalization. So
I think some of that is fear-driven, though.
I agree. I absolutely agree. I see
like
it all the time.
Colonoscopy or mammogram. Well, if I go and get a colonoscopy, they might find something.
You're right.
Well, wouldn't you rather find it at a stage one than a stage four when it's incurable?
That's exactly it. You know, like those tests are not fun to have. I certainly don't. I mean, the prep for a colonoscopy is really not fun. Or a breast mammogram. Like, it's not a comfortable situation. However, it's important to find those issues that are small and when they're small, as opposed to waiting until, you know, and then down the road dealing with them, they're bigger and then
greater and prioritizing your health, making your health a priority.
Definitely.
What types of tips do you give patients to stay motivated for health care, to take care of their health and be proactive?
Yeah, I mean, again, it's just really recommending that they follow up routinely with their PCP, making sure they get the tests that are recommended. You know, as far as, again, you know, working towards those goals and making them small and appropriate and important to the patient. Because I think if I'm creating a goal that's really not important to them, they're not going to work towards it. They're going to want to do their own thing. So it's really kind of listening to what they're saying and then kind of then translating it into some kind of effective way of resolving a problem. So, and I, you know, as I said, also the sometimes you're just making those goals even just for today. You know, so today, as opposed to drinking 4 cups of coffee, I'm going to drink 3 cups of coffee and regular strength coffee and then 1 decaf or 1 glass of water, or something that's small. I think that that's important because they've got to be able to take some ownership of success. And I think when you can say, well, I've done this, then they're able to kind of move along and improve from there, build from there. So I think it's helpful.
I think behavioral change is so hard for people.
Oh, it's absolutely,
Now, I believe that early detection and prevention are really the key to keeping most medical conditions under control. What are your thoughts around that?
Absolutely. I totally agree. I mean, just following up regularly with your doctor and following the recommended plan. And not that you do it blindly, but more hopefully on an educated level because you've asked the questions that need to be asked. I think that it's, you know, it's appropriate to kind of try to get the care you need, but also try to understand the care you need. And hopefully be in agreement with the plan. If you're not in agreement, then you do need to have that conversation with the doctor or a nurse or whomever. So definitely, you know, proceed that way. So, and I mean, that's basically...
Now, when you say not in agreement, do you mean I don't think this is the best course of action for me? Or do you mean more like, no, I'm not going to do that because I don't want to do that. Yeah. I don't want to quit smoking, or I don't want to stop drinking coffee.
It's hard because sometimes people are like that. And those are probably the most difficult patients because they think they're doing everything right, but they just don't want to make those changes because they feel like they knew a lot. And in that case, I would try and encourage the patient to have a bit more of an open mind about what their care team is offering them or directing them to do.
Mm-hmm. Do you bring in additional resources?
Oh, absolutely. I work with phenomenal people. I mean, I do. I work with social workers. I work with wellness coaches, with pharmacists. So, I mean, it's the group I work with is phenomenal. I can't say enough about them. So, and as well as we always, you know, tend to kind of reach out to the VNA that's able to provide the in-home services, and those staff members are my eyes and ears in the home because I primarily do my job telephonically.
Yeah.
So it's very beneficial to have people mm-hmm. in the home as well at times. So.
I think also that provides the patient with, if you have resources that, you know, other people or mm-hmm. support services, that helps
Correct.
The patient, number one, feel supported. Mm-hmm. Number two, it reinforces we're all kind of saying the same message.
Oh,
so if my
right.
doctor says it and then my nurse says it and mm-hmm. then I hear it from my dietitian,
yes.
maybe this is something I need to take
Absolutely.
Seriously.
Yeah, yeah. And then there are times that we also, you know, work with elder services and have those supports put in as a long-term type of remedy. Visiting nurses can only go in for a shorter period of time because of insurance mm-hmm. restrictions. But sometimes a family may need an additional home health aide or mm-hmm. person to help with personal care or meal planning or, you know, whatever, mm-hmm. just to kind of support that patient. And sometimes just sort of a companion to keep them, you know, help keep them safe so they're not falling or, mm-hmm. you know. So it's always good. I mean, in my mind, it's always good to have those additional supports in the home, although I understand, again, you know, as